Okay. All right. Let's see. Thank you. Okay. All right. So I am going to welcome the other people who are in the waiting room this evening shortly, but I wanted to start for all of those of you who have shown up on time. So good evening. Good morning, good afternoon. We have people from all over the country. I don't know about the world, but definitely the country. So welcome to our story sharing gathering of all about the things that matter. As some of you know, I've hosted Show and Tales for almost a decade. I've been delighted and honored to create space for people to share the stories of the things they keep. Some have never shared their stories before or since, but this simple yet courageous act changed their lives. I know because they've sent me messages and Facebook messages and texts. I'm grateful for this, this opportunity to connect. I'm also grateful to have gathered around me others who know the power of things to hold our stories. Those stories somehow get woven into the very fabric, the material of these objects. One of those kindred spirits is my good friend, former editor of Life Magazine and Life.com, Bill Shapiro, whose beautiful book, What We Keep, inspired the very name of the event tonight, when he and his co-author, Naomi Wax, interviewed hundreds of people, asking them, what object brings you joy, magic, and meaning? Tonight, we'll be inviting our special guests to answer that same question, but first, let us welcome Bill to the stage for a few, or the spotlight, Zoom spotlight, for a few opening remarks. Welcome, Bill. And okay, let's see if I can, okay.
I'm here.
You're here. I see that you're here, but I have to spotlight you.
Okay, the walk to the stage was very quick tonight.
There you go. Like I said, you're just swinging it. My VA is supposed to be here, but oh well. Welcome.
Good job, Marty.
It's all good. Thank you. So Bill, I as we had talked about before, needless to say, in our time together, knowing each other, and obviously in the What We Keep book club, I've gotten over and over again the same question. What inspired you and Naomi to do this project, to start this project?
Yeah, well, first of all, thank you so much, Marty, and thanks, everybody for being here. It's so great to see so many people who, yeah, care about stories and care about things. So to answer your question, there was a few threads that came together. I guess I should say first that the book was published in about 3 years ago. And so we started working on it maybe 3 years before that. And yes, that is it right there. So there were a few things that kind of came together to inspire us to start researching this book. And one of them was climate change and Superstorm Sandy. And when we saw the effects of that in Brooklyn, you know, with people hauling soaking ruined objects out of their house onto the street to throw away, you know, that kind of lodged in our collective brains. And then, you know, because of my job, the work I do, I look at a lot of photographs. I started seeing, as we all did, so many photographs of the Syrian refugees making their way to Turkey. And, you know, I noticed that they had like one bag with them that was not always a giant bag. And I started to wonder what they had in their bag. And you know, what do you take with you if someone says, you have to leave the home where your family's been living for 150 years, you have to leave there right now. What do you bring? You know, food, clothing, and, you know, one object to remind you of your entire family and history. And what would that object? So that started, that planted in our brains. But then we were actually at a very humble junk sale in upstate New York. And Naomi, my co-writer, sort of put her hand into a box of junk and pulled out this locket, and the locket was dated 1911, and it said, "My love forever." And we both started wondering, how does an object of such incredible value to people, to the giver and the receiver at one point, end up for sale to strangers at the end of some dumpy driveway, you know, off the highway somewhere? And it was really that that made us think about the story that that object once held and what happened when the story got separated from the object. And we sort of then started to ask our friends and their friends if they had one object that they keep and what it means for them. And it just sort of spiraled from there.
Very neat. Very neat. I think that, as I'd mentioned, I think that so many of us here can relate to that, the idea of, you know, all the photo managers, all the personal historians, all the writers, I think, all the artists and creatives, I think, have a deep, and needless to say, the people, professional organizers, totally can understand that, that challenge of like, what happens to this stuff? And unfortunately, when the story does detach from the stuff, often the stuff is left behind, but nobody wants to get rid of it still.
Well, unfortunately, I just had to live out the sort of thesis of the book, because my father passed away in July, and I was tasked with clearing out his apartment. And so there were things, there were objects that I'd grown up with and that I saw in his old photos that he'd grown up with, but it's like, you know, a 14-pound glass bowl. And I live in, what am I going to do with that? You know? And so these are things that I did have to take a photo of to keep the photo, but give the object to someone who needs to hold 156 tangerines at one time.
150 tangerines, that glass bowl would, you've counted it.
Yes.
And I am so sorry for your loss.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
So you absolutely relate. And the other, so thank you so much for starting us off. The other question that people that I've been curious about is during your process, see, you were one of the first authors that I've gotten to know more intimately and try to understand the process. So this took years to do. So during those years, what was the most surprising? What surprised you the most during that process?
Yeah. Well, a couple things. I would say that one is we as Americans think of ourselves as a very materialistic society. At least I think of us that way. But when Naomi and I interviewed, you know, like you said, hundreds of people, and these were people from red states and blue states, you know, rich and poor, black and white, super famous people like Mark Cuban and Melinda Gates, and then, you know, a guy who runs a barbershop or a counterfeiter and a cloistered nun, you know, a whole array. Not a single person chose an object of monetary value. zero. And so for me, that was kind of an eye opener. And I guess the other thing was that everybody we talked to had a story, and a real story, and a good story, and a heartfelt story, you know, loaded with emotion and thought, and they were willing to share that with strangers. And for me, I guess the lesson was, if you ask somebody a real question about, you know, and not quite framed like this, but what's meaningful in your life? What do you value? What do you care about? Who's important to you? They will answer you. And if you listen, if you really listen and ask follow-up questions, as us journalists are trained to do, you'll get some pretty amazing answers.
Wow. I think we had talked about, you know, wondering, the other day we talked about like how that just asking those questions, how just that opportunity where you sat down and asked these people that question, how that might have impacted them or still be impacting them today.
Yeah, you know, some people had never told the story before. You know, no one had ever asked, you know, in one case that comes to mind, why is that bottle opener, why is that ugly little bottle opener important to you? Why do you have that? And if you ask, they will tell you.
Well, we've talked about it. Like I started my events almost a decade ago, and I remember having personal historians, which we have one person on this call who identifies as a personal historian, who's a oral historian, that I know of at least. And I had a lot of people say, well, how do you get people to talk? And of course I said, I live in New York City. I started this in New York City. I don't have any problem with getting people to share a story if you just provide the space for it.
Right. And of course, it's not only loudmouth, obnoxious New Yorkers.
No. You
know, we got in our car and we drove, you know, 1800 miles through the Great Plains states and, you know, same thing, really. And I think, you know, to answer your previous question, what does it mean and what are they left with? I don't know 100% what they're left with, but there is this moment where people don't always know why they keep something. Like they know, oh yeah, my grandfather gave this to me, or I found this, or, you know, this crossed my path, but they sometimes, and they know it's important, but they don't actually think about the meaning in their life. And through the questions, almost like a therapist, I'm not licensed, I will say that, you know, you can sort of get to a place where they realize this came into my life, this object, at the same time when I had to make a decision between a job that paid me money and I had to work my ass off for hours, or to follow my passion. And, oh, you know what, this arrowhead that I found on a trip to Mexico, that's when I made the decision to follow my passion. And that's why I keep this thing. And I think when they reflect on that and think about it, it actually does help hold the story of their life and help them understand why they made some of the decisions they made.
Absolutely. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. I saw a bumper sticker the other day and it said, the best things in life aren't things.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah. But for me, who loves hearing the story, and you who listen to stories of things, things have a way of holding stories, you know?
They do, but you know what? It's like, for me, and you and I may differ on this, for me, the story is more important. And for me, like, yes, the story that we heard could have been about a locket, but it equally could have been about a ring or a football card or a shoe. In some ways, the object is kind of random, depending on who gave it to them, or when in their life they got it, or what they were going through.
Yes. Yes. I mean, needless to say, as many people who are on this event tonight who are going to be sharing their stories, I feel like it's not just an American thing, but I think that we're all kind of overwhelmed with the amount of stuff our life, the things, right? We're all dealing with that, no matter whether we're in tiny houses or trying to live location indie, or we actually help people with downsizing or help people with all their photos. Like there's no question we all need help with that. But how can we, as Matt Paxton said, how can we save those stories but not the stuff? Like, and that's what your book is, you know, was asking people, and you know, that's what we're going to ask people tonight. So, as well. So that brings us to the show and tell time. Yay. So we have lots of wonderful story sharers. So we'll have to keep the show and tell rolling. We'll do our best to keep up with the chat. I haven't done that well right at this moment, but we'll try to get back to that. But we ask you to look and listen to our sharers. So certainly feel free to communicate with, you know, send messages or communicate through the chat, but also do take your time to pay it, you know, to focus, to just listen and look at the things that people are sharing. I personally will be staying after this event closes for a good half an hour, and I'm going to invite any of the story sharers and the look and listeners to stay afterwards if you'd like to connect further. Yes. So without further ado, I think that if it's okay, I am going to invite Gail Rubin, aka the Doyen of Death, who I am so grateful to have connected with, who is helping deal with this issue of funeral planning.
Yes, funeral planning. Oh, God.
Thank you, Gail. Take it away.
Sure. Well, you know, and I can really appreciate, Bill, what you've gone through. Even though my parents are still alive, they've got COVID at the beginning of the year in January, not coming back to New Mexico. And we had to have an estate sale and sell their house. And oh my God, the emotions of going through a lifetime of stuff. It's heavy duty. So for today's sharing, I brought this cool little clock, which I have had for years. I think it came from one of my great aunt's apartments in Philadelphia. And it looks like it's from the 1930s. And I just love that it's a little round brass ball and it sits on this thing. And it is frozen in time, but I love the style. And I know that it had that family connection with my Philadelphia family. And I have a couple of other old clocks, which don't work. We're frozen in time, which says something, I think. and I love this little clock. Does it have magic? Does it have meaning? It means something to me, but I just think it's a cool little thing to keep around. And during this pandemic, I've been conducting Pilates classes with my faithful Pilates students 3 days a week in the morning in my living room. So that's where I keep the clock. And I just find my eye keeps falling on it and I'm just glad I have it. That's my story and I'm sticking to it. And I would like to invite everybody on this call to come to New Mexico or come online. We have the Before I Die New Mexico Festival coming up. And I met Bill through Marty at last year's virtual event. And it actually worked really well. And we have that conversation recorded. And it's available on YouTube through the Before I Die NM.com website. And I'm just asking for whatever you feel you can donate to participate. You can either access it through the Reimagine site or through beforeidienm.com, October 30th to November 2nd. And it is a wonderful wide-ranging series of conversations and speakers that will open your mind to what you need to know before you go.
And I was so, speaking of Let's Reimagine, for those of you who are not, those of you who are not familiar, I'm now doing the timing because somehow my VA is Miss MIA. That's okay. She's got young kids. So yes, the Let's Reimagine platform is phenomenal. And there are hundreds of collaborators like Gail and myself that are offering all kinds of ways to reimagine end of life. And last night was the opening ceremony of the Fall Festival called Grief, Growth, and Action. And and it was all about action and all about the small steps we can take to deal with end of life matters and how that can help us live in the present. So Gail's book, A Good Goodbye, it's funeral planning for those who don't plan to die. So she uses a little humor in all of that, which is
a lot of humor.
So do check out her her website when you get a chance. I'm going to be there in person offering an event. And the video that Gail talks about that Bill and I were part of the panel is all about what do you do with the possessions, right? What do you do with these the possessions after somebody passes away. Did you want to say something, Bill?
No.
Okay. Okay, so I think we needed to, I need to ask Sky to come up if-
I'm here.
You're here, okay. Let's see if I can find you and add you to spotlight you. Let's see, what's going on, add spotlight. Okay, all right, there you go. So welcome, Sky.
Thank you.
I was so excited when I saw that Sky is part, as many of you might know as well, this event was inspired by the Save Your Photos Month as part of the photo managers community that I'm a part of. And I was so thrilled when I saw them offering a live Q&A with Sky. I think that's on Thursday, right?
It is on Thursday, yes. Okay. It's a busy week.
It's a very busy week. And you've been dealing with a lot this week, but thank you so much. A filmmaker, if you haven't had a chance to see Lives Well Lived, please check that out. That is being offered through the Save Your Photos month through the photo manager. So we can pop some of that stuff in the chat at some point, but I'm going to let you take it away, Sky.
Yeah, well, thank you so much for having me and for letting me go first. Or second, but early on. And I'm from Philly too, Gail. So I have that Philly connection. but what I actually chose was a wooden spoon. And I don't know if those of you can, if you can see the poster for Lives Well Lived back there. This is my grandmother's wooden spoon. And my grandmother and I cook together. And this is definitely, was my inspiration and my inspiration for the film, but definitely my role model in life. I started filmmaking because She never wrote a recipe down. All of you that are good cooks, you never write recipes down. I know that. And the only way that I was going to remember how to cook what she did was to video her. And that led to a feature film that's now on PBS, where I interviewed 40 people that were 75 and older and wanted to know more about their lives. So that's why I've kept the spoon. You can see it's totally worn and burned. But every time when I cook, I use it and I think of my grandmother and I feel her presence. And I think the third question was, what can someone learn about you through the story of this thing? I would say the thing that they could learn is that anything is possible. I mean, I did a film out of a love of my grandmother. And I think if you're passionate about something, you can make anything happen. And the more personal the story, the more universal it becomes. And so I credit my grandmother with that. And I just want to say one of her mottos was to always be kind. So I always think about her all the time with that. And then what do you want someone to know about you, which is the fourth question? I would guess my passion is really doing a lot of intergenerational projects now because of the film, because I had this opportunity to interview these 40 amazing people who I feel like the greatest gift my grandmother gave me was that she introduced me to 40 new grandparents. And I want other people to have that connection. There are so many people that are disconnected. And one of the things that I read when I was doing the research for my film was that the last 100 years is the first time in human history that we've looked to anyone other than our elders for advice. And I really feel the world is suffering as a result. And so what I'd want you to know about me is that that's my passion, is making intergenerational connections happen. And my new film that I'm working on now is all about how those intergenerational connections happen through food. So you can look for that coming up in probably a couple of years. And then what do you want to happen with this thing when you die? I have a younger brother who also cooked with my grandmother in the kitchen, and I would want him to have that.
Can I ask a super quick question? I wonder if you still use the spoon when you cook, or is it like on a shelf somewhere?
Oh, no, I use it. My grandmother would want me to use it. It's well worn. And I feel like my grandma's juju comes out in whatever I make when I cook with it. So I feel like, you know, that's the beauty of it, is that it's meant to be used. And I feel her presence every time that I use it. So I'm not one of those people that keeps things on a shelf. I like to enjoy them. I think life is meant to be enjoyed. And it's, for me, more about, you know, this is about the thing, but it's really about the experiences. When we look back on our life, these things remind us of experiences. And that's why we love them so much. And so for me, I mean, I can still picture myself in my grandmother's kitchen using the spoon and stirring the pot with her.
That is beautiful. I love that. I like your word of juicing. And my mom, who might be on this event tonight, would just be delighted with the fact that there were families that cooked together. Because of course we didn't come from a family like that. So it's just so important. I'm so excited to hear about your new project. And I love the idea of intergenerational connections, providing space for that. So I hope we can continue a conversation about that, because I'm working with a lovely gentleman who's on this call, we're doing family show and tales. Mm-hmm. And it's all about, like, you know, like, do you know the stories of the things in your grandparents' house? Do you know the stories of the things that are in your children's bedrooms? Do your children know the stories of the things you keep? Like, it's powerful work. So I hope we can continue that conversation. Thank you so much for joining. I know you're going through a challenging
That's all right. I'm very happy to be here.
And I can't wait to see you on Thursday.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you so much. So I want to bring Nora up because she wanted to be on the earlier side. So Where are you, Nora?
So I waved, I do some jumping jacks. Hello.
Hello.
I'm here.
There you go. Thank you.
I have been discovered.
Search. So I literally met Nora last weekend at Camp Indy in Kent, Connecticut. And so this is a community that Trav is one of the founders of, who's also going to be a story sharer. And he, these are people who want to travel and work, you know, work on the road, work while traveling. So I met Nora and she was one of our presenters and she shared something that made me think I've got to get her on. So what she said was, and I'm going to leave it to you to take it from there.
Brilliant. Well, thank you for the glowing introduction and thank you very much for having me. So in 2006, I sold everything I owned. And I did so I could embrace my lifelong dream of traveling the world long-term and in a culturally immersive way. I didn't actually sell everything, but that's beyond the scope of my 3 minutes. But what I said that caught Marty's attention was that, you know, when you travel, when everything that you own fits into a bag, you have to be very selective about what goes in there. So as I was traveling the world full time, consumerism became a non-issue, which ultimately meant, though, as the years went by, as things would wear out, then I would need to replace those things. And I would replace those things with whatever I bought in whatever country I was in. So eventually I reached a point where everything I owned was a souvenir of sorts. And it continues to be the way. I made sure I wore everything. Is from somewhere else in the world. Like this is from the Southern Caribbean. This is from Costa Rica. This is from Vietnam. This is from St. Martin. There's a lot of stories. I could tell stories for everything that I have right now. And that was really an amazing experience. And certainly when I travel, even if I don't travel with everything that I own anymore, whenever I do travel, I make sure that anything that I get, A, has a story, and B, then is something that I can use every day. So, you know, similar to the cooking spoon that you get to use every day and you get to be reminded of that amazing experience. Now, the story that I actually want to tell today is of an item. Bill mentioned a little earlier that sometimes an item has a story before it even comes into your life. And what I have to show you today is exactly that kind of item. I was in Cuenca. I was in Guatemala, Antigua in Guatemala. And someone told me about a shop where you could buy material that's used, but the authentic woven material from the indigenous tribes around Lake Atitlan in Guatemala. And I thought, well, there's no better souvenir, there's no better thing to have. If I wanna get some material from Guatemala, I want it to have a story and a history. So I went into this store and just found reams and reams of old shirts and dresses and just pieces of material that I don't even know necessarily what they were or what they had been, but I picked out the pieces of material that spoke to me the most. And I brought them back to my home base, which is here in Toronto, Canada. And I had them made, this is one example right here. I had some of the material made into cushions. I used other pieces of material to cover my dining room chairs. And now I have, every time I sit on the couch and watch TV, I'm reminded of the experience that I had in Guatemala, and also too of the history of this. I mean, the fact that this wasn't made for a tourist to buy, but instead was and trust me, a lot of these pieces of material were well used. And so I had to find, you know, something that didn't have too many holes in it, but the fact that this was something that somebody wore at one point, the fact that, you know, I sometimes like to daydream about who had this, who made this, and how it ultimately made it into my own hands. And certainly now, all of the things that not I'm only wearing, but also that I've been able to populate my place with have similar stories. These scrolls behind me, this is my first ever trip. When I was 16 years old, I toured China with a ballet and I bought these scrolls. And when I said I sold everything, I didn't sell absolutely everything. I kept the things that were priceless or irreplaceable. And those scrolls I considered to be both priceless and irreplaceable. So Melissa's been in the same store in, I forgot what it was called, in Antigua, Guatemala. It's a very popular store, I think, and they've got amazing stuff. So definitely to enjoy the things that we have, to enjoy the stories. Like, I don't bring anything into my life anymore unless it has a story.
Yeah. Oh, thank you so much, Nora. That was perfect. And that was exactly why I was like, I need you up there, because I think especially for location independent people or tiny house living or intentional living or minimalist, we all have a special situation where we're trying to look at our things, and they either need to have a purpose or a story. So, and that is the
ideally both.
Exactly. Thank you so much. And that's a perfect segue to invite the beginning of the middle up to the stage. So our very own Matt Paxton, I met him through the photo managers conference. It wasn't last year, it was the year before, during right at the at COVID time, when we were when Kathy and her team, Kathy Nelson and her team of the photo managers, ended up like last minute going, oh my God, what are we, you know, what are we going to do? We're not going to meet in person. So what are we going to do? And so they did an amazing job bringing everything virtual. And that's where I met Matt and fell in love with his work and his demeanor. And yes, you might know him as the host of Hoarders, but he also started what I'm calling a kinder and gentler Hoarders, which is my legacy list. Or the legacy list with Matt Paxton. I'm so grateful to invite him to join and share the story, because even minimalists end up having something. Hi, Matt.
Hello, everybody. How are you?
Thank you so much for joining us. And I don't think you need much of an introduction.
Most people are wondering why I look familiar. And it's because you watch Hoarders. That's usually why people stare at me and don't know why. Can everybody hear me okay? I've got audio. Yes. Okay. Yes. This is awesome. I love all the theory things. I mean, every person is saying a couple things that I want to yell and scream. Yes. I've spent the last 20 years helping people clean out their houses. It's hard to believe. I've been doing this. I was 24 when my dad, my stepdad, and both my grandfathers died. And I was a very immature young 24, and I had to clean all their houses out. And I started just like losing it. I mean, I cried for like a year, because I had to clean all these houses out, and I had all these little items that meant so much to me. And so I ended up staying. I mean, I'm still cleaning houses 20 years later, because it was so emotional. One of my grandfathers had said, if something sucks, do it as a job, because people will pay you to do it. And he was right. I'm still doing it. But it's the stories that kept me going. And that's why I transitioned to PBS about 3 years ago. We're actually filming season 3 of Legacy List right now. I love it. I love it, Suzanne. I love cleaning houses, because I get all these stories. Like, I get this show and tell. My job is this show and tell. Someone hands me an item, and I say, you want to keep it or get rid of it? And they go, well, let me tell you about my grandma. And then they tell me about this amazing spoon that ended up becoming a movie that's on PBS, like Sky did. I mean, that is exactly how it happens. And it happens every day. I'm very lucky that I get to do that. And then the person gives me a hug, and then they hand me a check. Like, it's the greatest thing in the world. And I moved, gosh, I became a minimalist a year and a half ago, myself and my three sons. And we moved, we sold everything, got rid of everything. We literally got rid of about 90% of our stuff. And we moved to Atlanta with my fiance and her four children. So I am now a newly subscribing minimalist with seven children under the age of 12. Yes, Athena, seven children, six boys under the age of 12. So my principles are really being challenged these days. But where that's different for me is, yeah, Brady Brunch and I'm Alice is the big joke there. I do all, most of the thing. And the challenge here is, I am trying to get young children to get excited about stories. That's my real life thing now. I mean, I do a lot at work, but yeah, I mean, it's really focusing on these kids not buying into just junky toys and not buying into the, you know, crap that we all see. But how do I get them? I mean, Nora, you're not 12-year-olds, right? Like, how do we get these people to get excited about stories at a young age? And I call them story starters, basically. So the items that I keep are story starters. And I'm going to share a little silly item. This is a Willie Nelson Christmas tree ornament. I am really big into Willie Nelson. And I know that sounds silly. It's because my dad loved Willie Nelson. And I saw him once when I was a kid. I lived in Hawaii. I got stuck in Hawaii during 9/11 and couldn't get a flight home. And so I had to stay there for like 6 months before I could get a flight. I know, tough place to get stuck. And I this old scraggly guy ran around every day. Every lunch, I'd come back from surfing, I'd get a taco. And this old scraggly guy would run around, like the slowest runner I've ever seen, but he was super consistent. And I loved that. And I didn't know until like a year later that that was Willie Nelson. His farm was like right up the way. And I didn't know it. So believe it or not, that's not the story. Why do I have this Willie Nelson ornament? For me, I'm all about Christmas with tree ornaments. And because we don't really keep a lot. I mean, the life that I've had over the last 20 years, I've seen stuff pretty much really hold people back. And they've missed out. The excitement of their life has been overwhelmed by stuff. But for me, I'm okay with a lot of Christmas tree ornaments because every ornament represents someone in my life that's passed away. And the seven children that I have and my wife and my fiance, they never met really any of the people that raised me. They all passed before the life, this amazing life that I have. They never met any of these people. And so I love the day we put the tree up because everybody, all the kids go, well, who's that? Who's that? Who's that? Who's that? Who's that? And I get to tell these awesome stories. It's kind of like show and tell each day. And I tell these amazing stories. And I just love to have the story starters. And when I was a little kid, I was raised by my mom, a single mom. She did the real work of raising me and making me a young man. And I got to go to all those other people's houses for vacation and weekends, but my mom did the hardcore work. And one year somebody dropped off a Christmas tree on our front porch. I remember we got home from church and I got to put this on gallery mode because I want to see everybody else shake their head on this one. We got home from church Wednesday night and there was a tree on our front porch. And I said, Mom, why did someone drop a tree off at our house? And she goes, I don't know, just being nice. And that was the day I realized that we were poor. I had no idea that we were poor. And I said, Mom, are we poor? And she's like, yeah, totally. And I was like, oh, okay. And I never heard anything about it. And didn't know we were poor the rest of my life. Because my mom worked like three jobs to put me through, you know, high school and college. And I ended up doing the same thing. And I'm doing the same thing now with my kids. And it just... The Christmas tree was for me just kind of a symbol of like, all right, I got a family now. And I didn't realize till last year when I had my new family of all seven kids, how important that Christmas tree is. So I love little Christmas tree ornaments because they're story starters. And I think all these items are story starters. And my TV show, little plug, my TV show Legacy List, if you haven't seen it, it's on PBS. And we, a family is downsizing, just like what Bill went through with your parents last year. Pretty much everybody on this call is going to go through it at some point. Families that are downsizing have to go through their stuff. And we help the family find or relocate or find out more information on their five items that really tell their family story. And for us, that's called a legacy list. And I just love it. And Bill, you're totally right. It's never an expensive item. It has nothing to do with money. Ever. And you know, I've been lucky to spend 20 years with a really amazing, regular, normal families. And it was really cool. I mean, this spoiler alert, there's a family coming up this season that we just filmed. And the guy was a professional NBA player. He coached 10 NBA teams or he won 10 NBA championships. And those 10 NBA championship rings were not on his legacy list. They weren't in the top five that matter. You know, and so I was like, oh, man, that says a lot. I remember asking him, I was like, really? And he goes, man, that's just work. You know, and it was special notes from people that he had met along the way. That's what really mattered to him. But this is an awesome event. I would love to see this happen because every one of us has a story that can change everybody's life. I just love it. It's super cool.
And it's so, it's so amazing what you said, Matt, that it reminded me of a couple of things. One is my dad always gave me Christmas ornaments. And when you were on Kathy's event a couple of weeks ago, when I ended up direct chatting with you, you had mentioned about your dad and his ponytail. And I was just, oh my God, we've got so much in common. But I think Bill wanted to say something for a minute.
Oh, I was just going to mention that in our book, we interviewed Mark Cuban, who owns the Dallas Mavericks and a basketball team. And unlike your coach, Matt, he did talk about his one object was his championship trophy. So,
Well, he dreamed about buying that team as a kid when it was an absolute unreachable dream.
It was more than a trophy, but I guess it always is. But NBA,
Beautiful. Thank you so much, Matt. And again,
thank you.
My legacy list or legacy list with Matt Paxton. Amazing.
You can watch it. You can watch it free online. I'll put it in the chat, but you can watch it free online anytime you want.
It's just wonderful. And there's a few members, colleagues of the photo managers who have been part of it. And I have somebody on this call tonight that I've encouraged to sign up for your being part of it next season, Matt. Because I'm like, she showed
sign me. Sign up. I just put it in there. Yeah.
And she showed me her mother's attic recently. And I was just like, oh my God, you've got to meet Matt Paxton.
telling you, we love any regular, normal families, just nothing fancy, nothing expensive. As long as it's not a Singer typewriter, I'm interested, or a Singer sewing machine, I'm very interested. But please, I just put the thing in the link.
Yeah. And if you know anybody who's looking to be a part of the show and be a part of telling the stories of the things that matter, which I think is a perfect time for me to bring up the two people who ended up joining me at a What We Keep book club since the photo managers conference this spring, who we all got inspired one another with this idea that obviously photos tell stories. We know that. And September is Save Your Photos Month. But we know it's not just about saving photos, it's about saving the stories. So I'm wound with, the 5,000, the 10,000, the 20,000 photos. So we want to encourage people to have a considered life, like you talked about, Matt, intentional life, making choices about things. And so I want to bring, if it's okay, I'm going to bring up Kathy and Faith. I'm going to have Kathy start, but I think that these two Canadians have kept me close company for 6 months because they've been under lockdown, seriously, as some of you know. And they've made my Sundays incredibly enjoyable. So I just want to welcome both of them to be here and to share their stories. So I'm gonna back off and have you take the stage.
All right.
Yeah.
Thanks so much, Marty. And just I've so much enjoyed the story. So my object, hopefully we can see it.
Okay.
This ship in a bottle first, why do I keep it? First of all, it's just really cool. You're not finding a lot of ships in the bottle laying around anymore. And so I've had it, it's been in my family. I remember it from when I was a little girl, looking at it, trying to figure out how the ship got in that bottle and trying to figure out how did that ship that's bigger than the top of the bottle get in there. And that was a fascination with us kid, which kind of sad now that I know how they do it, because that kind of took some of the magic away. But the whole idea of the ship in the bottle. The other reason this is a very meaningful object to me is my mom's name is on this ship. And she has a unique name, so it's not like I found a ship with Mary on it. It's got my mom's name on it. So that means a great deal to me. I, like Matt, I had a single mother raise me most of my life, and I didn't know we were poor either, but I did know she worked a whole heck of a lot too. So the objects that I have that from when I was a kid are very important to me. The other thing about this is the origin story of this ship in a bottle. So I keep it also because it reminds me of my grandfather. My grandfather was an immigrant to Canada in 1929. He fought in the British Army in World War I. And he didn't fight. He was in the Veterans Guard in World War II in Canada. And you go, well, what was he doing guarding in Canada? We had a German prisoners of war were shipped over and put in camps all over Canada. We had about 34,000 prisoners, predominantly German. And my grandfather was at, it was Camp 130 in CB, Alberta, which is about 80 kilometers. It's about an hour from where I live for the unkilometer people. And he guarded at a camp there. And this was made by a prisoner for him. And so the meaning of that to me, the fascination with it, many of those German prisoners of war, they weren't really trying to escape, because this is in the middle of nowhere. It was in the Rocky Mountains in Kananaskis area. So there was nowhere to go. Some tried to escape. There have actually been books written by the prisoners who tried to escape. They almost always came back, because even if you got out of the compound, where were you going to go in from the middle of nowhere? So I think it says a lot to the cooperation between the guards and the prisoners. The guards had only rifles, like single shot rifles. They didn't have automatic weapons or anything. And eventually the prisoners built their camp, and initially it was tents. They built their barracks and everything. And they had things there that they made. I have a couple other things. They were made by the prisoners in the camp. And so it says to me, patience, perseverance, and something about the cooperation between them, even at that time of war, with having this. And I think what I learned from it is the magic is just this whole story, and the ship itself is magic. I wish I could find out who built it. I would like to know what happened to that prisoner who made this ship in a bottle and put my mom's name on it. I'd like to know, my mom was one of six kids. I'd like to know why her name got on it, because there aren't five more of them with anybody. So I don't know that what was going on at that time. So that's to me what, as I've been doing with Marty and Faith for all of Save Your Photos Month, partly inspired by Bill's book. Well, maybe totally inspired by your book, Bill, but is trying to get people to tell their stories, because they're objects. And I was shocked, because I was telling my son, who's 24, that I was going to do this. He goes, well, what are you talking about? I said, this boat. And he goes, or this ship in a bottle. And he goes, what is that anyway? And I'm like, oh man, I mean, my kids don't even know the stories. So I want everybody to tell their stories. And some things where I'd like this to end up is either to stay in my family, or I may actually want it to go to, there is a museum from that prisoner of war camp, and there's also the Canadian Military Museum. And I feel like it probably belongs there, because it's a little piece of history. And I think all of our own stories and telling them, they're part of history too. So.
Absolutely. And I think that that's a critical part as well, is to recognize that your history, your objects are not necessarily only your own. Mm-hmm. I know people get frustrated, and sometimes just they want to get rid of things, but needless to say, I have archivist friends and historian friends who would love to help you pass those things on to historical societies or museums who would like them. So keep that in mind as well. So thank you so much, Kathy. That's you learned so much history and personal history from that. So Faith, can you take it away?
Yeah. Well, hello everyone. I'm Faith from Toronto. And the item that I brought tonight is my wooden shoe. It's just, there's just one of them. I have the right one. I don't know who has the left shoe, but I've got the right one. And I was given this when I was 5 years old, just about to turn six. And the kindergarten that I went to, everybody got, when they were going into grade one and leaving kindergarten, got a wooden shoe. And on the back of it is written, "To remember your days in kindergarten, June 1968, Mrs. C. Klein." And Mrs. Klein and her husband owned and operated a kindergarten. They were both Dutch. They were from Holland originally and had met in Montreal and then moved to St. John, New Brunswick and opened up this daycare. So anyways, I've kept my wooden shoe for many years, and I had lost touch with them, during the time I was in high school and so on and so forth. And then when I was in my mid-20s, I decided I would go to Holland. It was a place that I'd always wanted to go. So I got back in touch with them, and they were absolutely thrilled, number one, that I was going to Amsterdam and Rotterdam, where they were from, but also that I still had my shoe. And so I kept in touch with them up until probably 15 years ago when they passed away. And I just, they would phone me on my birthday and send me a Christmas card, Christmas time. And so I kind of know that even now, like if they knew that I still had this wooden shoe after almost 50 years, that they'd be thrilled to death. And I was thinking today, I could just hear Mrs. Klein say, his name was Cornelius, but she called him Case. And she'd be saying, Case, come here, come look on the computer, it's Fish. She's still got her wooden shoe. So I know that they would be absolutely thrilled to know that I still have it. And to answer the question, which I had never thought about what I would do after I'm gone. And I thought, maybe I should make this into an urn and have my body put in my wooden shoe and have it buried. So that's my story.
Oh, wow. I love that. So like I said, we've been spending almost every Sunday for the last 6 months together. And Faith has, being the writer that she is, has written full stories of about these 30 objects. They're like a 30, let's do this 30-day challenge. And no wonder they call it a 30-day challenge, right, Faith? It's a challenge. but it's been delightful, and I can't wait for the book to be in production. So, realistically, we talked about in our book group that, everybody on this call could actually end up creating sort of your own What We Keep, right? Kathy, you could do that for your kids. We can all do, like, we don't have to go and do this big project like Bill and Amy did. But we can do it for our own things. And now with, Blurb and Snapfish and everything, we have the ability to create our own What We Keep to pass on to our family, right?
Yeah, so, that's what I plan on.
I can't wait, Faith. You've been an inspiration. You've been an inspiration for me. So thank you very much. And we're encouraging people to, you know, think about the things around them and the stories that they tell, and writing them down, or at least recording them on video or audio, or you know, at least telling them to your loved ones, like your son or your family members. So I am going to, I'm just looking at my list now, because I don't think I've gotten any direct messages about people necessarily wanting to go next. So I'm just gonna pick the person that I can see right on my list, right here in front of me, and that is Athena. So I'm going to have you come up on stage. So I met Athena through a small business gathering, where she ended up taking a small group of us and encouraging us. She was a Las Vegas showgirl. She was a principal dancer in Jubilee. And as we're all talking about history, she's doing a history of showgirls. She's got a podcast, she's got lots of things. And she was also, I ended up having her and her magician be performers at my birthday, you know, COVID birthday, you know. What are you gonna do
awesome.
For your birthday? So you're gonna hire your performers, friends who entertained all of us. So I thank you very much, and I'm going to hand it over to you. Take it away. Thank you.
Thank you, Marty. Thank you for that fabulous introduction. Yes, I was a Las Vegas showgirl, and I'm actually learning I wasn't actually a showgirl. I was a dancing nude, or I was a principal dancer by the end, but there is a distinction. And if you want to learn more about it, you just listen to my podcast. It's called Showgirls Life. I started this whole business shortly after I met Marty. And I was like, oh, I'm going to create a blog. And then I got the idea to do a podcast and interview old showgirls. And so the reason that happened was because Jubilee closed in February of 2016. I was in this show from 2000 to 2005, and it was just another job, dancer job. And it wasn't until I saw the last shows, like the last 3 weeks before it closed, that I realized like the magnitude of that experience in my life. So I brought, it's a piece of paper, but it's framed. This, let's see, make sure, oh, maybe I should have taken it out of the frame. Can you guys see it?
Yes. Yes, we can see it.
Okay. Yeah. So this is me, and it is just a digital comp of a possible Jubilee souvenir program cover. We did this massive photo shoot for 3 days. We had to do a photo shoot from like 10 in the morning to like four or five. And then we did two shows for 3 days. It was awful. And the other thing I should note is that we weren't allowed to take pictures of ourselves in costume. It was absolutely forbidden. We were told that it was the designers that said, you cannot photograph our creations. I have later since, interviewed the designer of this costume, Pete Menefee, who won Emmy Awards. He's famous for doing Rockettes and ice shows and things. And he said, that was never us. It had nothing to do with us. But anyway, this is just a piece of paper. It's a 9x13 piece of paper. And it was given to me by the assistant company manager, Diane Palm. And she said, I thought you might want to have it. It wasn't the chosen option, but I thought you might want to have it. So this is the only picture I have of me in this costume in a stage setting. So you can kind of see there's people in the back, they're kind of blurred out. I do have photos of myself in costume, and I do share them on my YouTube and my website, but you know, it's like in the bathroom or the hallway, or, you know, it's not pretty. So this became really, really important to me after the show closed, and I realized, crap, the showgirl is going to die. Because there's a few of us that are preserving the history, but that's why I started the podcast. And I've interviewed, I think, 45 people about their experience, and they're telling their stories. And everyone's like, it's hard to get people to tell their stories because they think they're not exciting or interesting. I'm like, no, we were showgirls. And you know, so that is, that's my thing. And I actually, I do know what I want to do with it when it's time to go. I'm of course going to ask my children if they want it. They do want my costumes, as you can see in the back. I have tons of costumes that I've made, and Marty got to try some on in that special event. But if they decide not, or they want to keep it for a while, I'm going to make sure that is donated. All of my ephemera from being a showgirl will be donated to the UNLV Las Vegas Library. They have a special collections that is all about showgirls. And I have visited a couple times and gotten to see some legacy items from Don Arden, who was the creator of the show, old sketches, programs, all kinds of stuff. So that's where my stuff will go. I'm really good friends with the curator, so I know exactly where my stuff's gonna go.
So yeah. That is wonderful. That is delightful. So yes, it's just a little piece of paper. It's interesting, those stories of, oh, you shouldn't take a picture of, you don't own the whatever. So that's an interesting part. I've learned a lot. And I was also lucky to be on her podcast once.
One of a handful of non-showgirls.
That's right. I was not a showgirl. Not ever, but it was such a wonderful experience. And it's all about creating confidence and owning, you know, yourself, you know, owning the stage, so to speak, however that is. So I thank you so much, Athena. I really appreciate it. Do check, please pop anything into the chats of the events or things so people can follow you. Okay. And I really appreciate you joining. As always, you've been a great support. Thank you.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you. All right, so I did get a message. I'm trying to keep track of it. So a message from Rachel. And if you're ready, Rachel, I'm going to add you, Rachel Codenas. So Rachel, hello.
So great to see you. And I love the energy you're bringing to these items. It's awesome. 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 Awesome.
Yeah. So I met Rachel through Gail Rubin, who had to leave us a little early, her Before I Die New Mexico last year. As we mentioned, Bill and I and Rachel and another friend, Karen Hyatt, were on a panel all about, you know, what do you do with the possessions after somebody passes away, after somebody dies, or downsizing, obviously, but in this case, it was specifically after somebody dies. And so Rachel has her own story all about that. She had to go through it herself. And I am just so grateful to have connected with her further and to talk about partnerships and collaborations and all kinds of things to help people with their stuff. So I'm gonna let you take it away.
Well, thank you. And I am not a Debbie Downer on this. And I don't even feel sorry for the Debbies in the world that I use that expression. But I just actually got off, and I was a little late coming on because I just got off on a program that I was doing on possessions and what to do with yours and your loved ones' possessions after you pass, or is you're downsizing, right sizing. And I wrote a book, Finding Peace, One Piece at a Time, What to Do with Your Loved One's Possession. I'll pull it up in a minute. But what I really wanted to talk to you guys about, and why I really wanted to step forward, is that everybody asks, what do you keep? What do you get rid of? How do you this? How do you that? And there's two, to me, it's two simple things. If the item tells the story, or if it provides a connection to your loved one, you keep it. Otherwise, you don't have to keep it. So I have to go out on a limb for a second. I did have a tragedy. My husband passed away when we were really young. My daughter was 2 years old. And so I have these shoes, and they just happen to be on my desk right now because I just did a presentation prior to this of what to keep. And so these shoes, my husband passed away 28 years ago. These shoes are what my daughter had on when he passed away, and I was at the hospital, and I remember, and I talked about the story in my book, how I bent when I was, my head was down, all I could see were her shoes. And one might say to me, Rachel, why do you keep those? Right? Because I look at these, and first of all, I cannot believe this child fit into these shoes because she just got married. But more so, I see these, I don't see them sad anymore. I see them as, we had such a special little unit. Although short, we had such a special unit. And I look at these and I just cherish them. But to take the shoes one step further, I didn't know I said this, but when my husband passed away, I said over and over again to everybody in front of me, everybody, who's going to walk her down the aisle? And my sister-in-laws and my sisters would say to me, Rachel, oh my goodness, she's 2 years old. Why does it matter who's going to walk her down the aisle? But I said it over and over and over again. So I got to stick with the shoe theme for you. Daughter got married this year in the middle of all this horrendous, horrendous COVID stuff. And while I'm remarried and my living husband, as I call him, adopted her, he was walking her down our short little outside aisle. However, she put these shoes on. This is her late father's name that she had painted on her wedding shoes. So I had to bring this forward to you because what it took was, what do you keep? And she has listened to me present for 20 years on items to keep and what not to keep and what to this and what to that. So she took my whole shoe theme and took it to the next level for something that meant so much to me. So I really appreciate you giving me the chance to share this. But what I ask of all of you and the people that you speak with, figure out what tells the story, help people to understand what the story is and keep that connection, but everything else you don't have to keep. And thus I wrote the book of finding peace one piece at a time, what to do with your possessions, because you have to have that peace.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I'm so proud of you, Marty, for pulling all of us together because it's so special. And I see Bill over there. It's just so special for all of us to be together, helping each other figure out how to get through this life that we're trying to figure out.
Isn't that the truth? Right.
Right.
And what to hold on to, what to let go of, all of that, you know, thing. It really is important. Thank you so much. And I am going to invite, we're paying attention to the time. Let's see. I know Kathy, you wanted to come up and I am going to add you. Kathy, there you go.
Thank you, Marty. This is wonderful. I love all these stories. And I've always said, you know, even though the photo managers, you know, people think of photo organizing, but it's always been about the whole reason I started organizing photos was to tell a story. And if your photos are all unorganized, you can't tell a story. So I think we're all so equally wired in how we believe in this. And I said, Marty, I do want to talk because tonight I'm going to share an object about my wedding anniversary. And tonight happens to be my 30th wedding anniversary. And my husband really nicely got me 30 roses. So we're sitting here and he's kind of wandering the house, like looking at me like, we have an
good job, and, you know.
So
thank you for sharing your anniversary with us, Kathy.
I'm happy to. And you know, 3 decades, it feels, I woke up this morning, that one feels a little bigger than, I don't know, for something about 3 decades. So one of the items that I would, I really treasure and want to keep is something that only comes out once a year. And my husband and I started this when we first got married, and we go away, usually out for dinner on our anniversary. We're going to go in a couple weeks. Now we're, you know, it's Tuesday and retired, you know, after 30 years of marriage. So we can wait and do this next in another weekend. But we take a journal, we go out to dinner, and we usually write where we are. Like in 1998, we were at a restaurant in Chester, and my kids were with my sister at my, you know, who's babysitting them. And we kind of just list out what happened that year. And that year, I didn't know, I just pulled it open. My daughter actually was born in Abilene, Texas. And it's not that big. This is 30 years. It's just 2 journals. And we still have plenty of pages left in this journal. But it's really fascinating now, all these years, to go back and to kind of just see what we kind of picked out of the year. That what was it that, you know, we've had, you know, we've lost my parent. We've lost, you know, people have died. COVID has come, 9/11. My kids have grown from birth to to troubled adolescence to hopefully maybe a little more stable adulthood. So, you know, it's a journal filled with the true stories of life. It's not all like it was all wonderful. So that is just something that I treasure. And again, I don't think about it until you asked me to do this. And I thought, what would I do? And I knew it was our anniversary. And I thought, well, these are something that I really treasure and there's not much to it. And, but it's a great gift. And I think we would pass them down to my kids. I always, when I do this, think about my parents. You know, they didn't tell us the stories. I have the stories of like when my dad lost his job, I remember coming home and his car was in the driveway and he was smoking a cigarette and he had quit smoking. And, you know, I don't know what he felt, you know, I know he disappeared in the basement for a few years in the dark, you know, like, so obviously a deep depression overcame him and things, but he didn't write any of that down, right? My kids will know, you know, we've lost jobs and things have happened, so they can read about this and also see how you came out the other end. So stories in whatever way that you tell them, I think really matter. So that's it. That's my.
That's perfect. Because that's the theme of the Let's Reimagine is the grief, growth, and action. So it is about, like how the resilience, what, you know, like sharing those stories so that we know that it's not all like, it's not the social media where everybody's got their, you know, hair done and all that kind of stuff. It's like, it's real life. So thank you for sharing and thank you for all you do to bring together a wonderful community that I'm glad to be a part of. So thank you so much.
You're the best.
Thank you. All right, so I am going to pass it on to, I'm gonna see if Maureen, would you like to share tonight? I wasn't sure. I know that you're going through a challenging, you are here. So you are—
oh, now you can hear me.
There you go, yes. Yes.
All right.
So Maureen Taylor, AKA the photo detective, I am going to remove my spotlight and let you take it away.
Okay, thanks. I'm on my little phone since my computer crashed. But, you know, I work with people with their family photographs and get them, help them tell the stories of their pictures. And they often come to me with a single photograph out of the thousands that they have or the hundreds that they have. And I always wonder why that one photo, what makes that one photo so important? And so I try to get them to tell me the story of that one picture. So I was like, what should I show tonight for show and tell? And I guess, you know, I am about pictures and that's sort of what I do. I could share a vase from my grandmother. I have my grandmother's washboard for the woman that has the spoon. They all signify something, but I will share this like really horrible photograph of my great, great grandmother. It's terrible. I can't imagine anyone hung this on the wall and they did. But to me, why is this photograph so important? I just got it from my dad's first cousins who are still alive. And they gave it to me because they're afraid that they're much older and they're afraid of COVID and they wanted someone younger to have the picture. But to me, this woman, this woman represents so much for the time in which we're living today. She got married as a young woman. It was a shotgun wedding. The baby died. The husband ran off. I still have no idea what happened to him. Then eventually she married my grandfather and had a whole, she married my great grandfather and had a whole bunch of children. And then her husband died when she was pregnant with their last child. So he never met the last child. And she lost a brother that same year. For me, she represents that life has ups and downs, and if you're having a bad moment, I think about her and think about how we can pass through that moment and how it is possible to move on from tragedy. She's a symbol of that, but I'm not gonna hang that picture up in my office. I just can't do it. I find it kind of scary to look at her, but I'm quite pleased that they felt good enough to give that to me. So That's what I have to say tonight, Marty. But that's my one picture. Now, everything everyone said tonight really resonated with me because I had cleaned out everything. Everything was tidy. We moved, was great. Then we lost my in-laws. Then I moved my mother. Now I'm getting stuff from cousins and I really need to clean out all over again.
It's a never-ending process.
It's a never-ending process. Thank you for asking me to participate, Marty. This has been great.
Thank you so much, Maureen. And please follow. I've been listening to Maureen's podcasts as I'm driving my little Brooklyn, my little RV around the country. So they're very entertaining and informative. So thank you so much, Maureen, for
thank you, Marty,
being a part of it. So Andrew, are you here? I see that you're here. Are you up for, are you in P-Town? Did you make it?
How do you know that I'm in P-Town?
You said so.
Oh, okay, I was gonna say, I'm not like, I don't have the water behind me. It's also too dark.
You said you might be going and you have to pack something, just like Carolyn, who I'll get on next. So I'm gonna let you, so this is Andrew Lear, my friend who's a gay historian who has Oscar Wilde tours and Shady Lady tours. And it's been a pleasure. We've been co-organizing the LGBT history and culture meetup, which maybe some people are here joining us tonight from that, but I am just going to pass the spotlight over to you.
Well, everything everyone has said has something to do with what I'm gonna talk about, because in fact, this is something I got when I cleaned out my mother's house. But I was really lucky because I'm an extremely minimalist person. In fact, since the beginning of the COVID epidemic, I've been what I call high-end homeless, which is to say I kind of gave up both of my apartments in Boston and New York and had been living in sort of friends' country houses or things because I just don't need to be anywhere particular anymore. Mm-hmm. Like, there's no specific location I need to be in. And so I can't decide where I need to go next. And so in fact, I'm possibly on the verge of buying a condo, which my partner calls my $200,000 storage unit. Yes, it'd be like a place to put some stuff. But so I was really lucky when I cleaned out my mother's house. Well, I cleaned out. I didn't do anything. My mother was a very grand lady. She was a wonderful artist, an extremely successful artist, and also just fabulous person in every possible way. And she lived in a 17-room Victorian mansion, which was built by my grandfather, and which she had bought from her uncle, I guess, uncle or great uncle, I can't remember right at the moment. And it was packed with family stuff, including 18th century family china, and also my mother's artworks, it's all kinds of stuff. But luckily for me, I was teaching at Pomona College. This is Brookline, Massachusetts. I was teaching at Pomona College in California. And I did so much stuff about my mother's aging and dying, which went on forever. But luckily, when it actually happened, I wasn't there. And consequently, my brother and sister had to clean out the house. That's like my biggest victory in our family ever. And the great thing about it is my brother, very sharp financially, has a very good idea for whatever is really valuable and took all of that. And my sister is just super attached to everything to do with our family. And so she took all the rest. And consequently, I can go visit a museum of my family's possessions whenever I want to. I just go to my sister's house and literally the 1940s egg cups that my grandmother had are going to be on a shelf. It's like everything is there. Oh, so I, however, have nothing except my mother, as I said, was a really good artist. And she and I saw absolutely eye to eye about what her best work was. And the way she kept it for us was at a gallery show, she would just mark the things that we liked best sold. And so after the show, she would give them to us. And I have the collection of what I think my mother and I agreed were, not from her whole life, but when she was old, quite old, maybe 70, she went back to doing watercolors, which she hadn't done since art school. And it was a wonderful period of her work. And she also learned how to do all kinds of prints, and she was doing all kinds of print stuff. And I have a collection of these fabulous watercolors, but of course I couldn't bring them today because they're kind of big. But when my mother, because I'm at my friend's house in P-Town, where I did live for 10 weeks of the lockdown, and I'm planning to spend the next six. So, but when I was cleaning out my mother's house, I opened a drawer in the dining room, and underneath, so the drawer was lined with menus from the captain's table from the SS France, which my mother used to take back and forth to Europe. And I actually took a couple of times too, but I was too small to really remember it. But the other thing that was down there with the paper was this fabulous sketch. This is not what I told Marty I was going to show, because I thought the other thing would be too hard to understand visually. This is a sketch I found, that my pen and ink sketch that my mother did of herself. She's quite young in it, maybe the 40s.
Wow.
She was born in 25. So this is my mother possibly wearing riding clothes.
Yeah. Jod person.
My mother as a kind of cool young person. It's certainly not the phase I knew her in. So anyway, I really love it. And as you can see, I've had it framed. And this and a picture of my college advisor, who was my other favorite person on earth, are the things that are next to my bed.
Oh, wow. That's so beautiful. It's so beautiful. Yeah, I love that. That is so great.
I adore this sketch.
It's adorable.
She was a super, she's picked up another genre, like pen and ink, whatever. She could do anything, including sew, cook, anything you do with your hands and your eyes.
Wow.
Incredibly skillful.
Amazing.
Yeah, wow. Yeah. And what I want to do with it when I die, it's so many people were so attached to my mother. And she was probably more attached to my boyfriend than she was to anyone else. With the exception of me, but the last cogent words you spoke were, "Where's Corey?" So,
oh my God.
Yes, you wanted to have a very funny story. My cousin came and said, "Hello, Aunt Amelia." And she looked up and said, "Where's Corey?
Where's Corey?"
Oh my goodness. I was like, forget you. But anyway,
I can relate.
Corey might want it. And then ultimately my nephews were very attached to her. We'll all want it. So that's where it'll go.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Andrew. I appreciate it. I love your idea of your $200,000 storage unit too. Cause it's like, that reminds me of George Carlin's, he does a shtick about stuff and he's like, it's just a pile of stuff with a roof over it. So everybody has their pile of stuff with a roof over it. That's what a house
is. I just want to have a room to hang my paintings in. That's all.
I know, right? Well, thank you so much. I really appreciate you joining us from P-Town. So I do.
Wait a minute.
I tried my best to get us on time, but we have people left, and I hope I understand if people have to leave. I totally understand that I didn't manage the time very well, but I am still going to stay and invite the rest of the story sharers to share. And if you're able to stay with us, please do. And otherwise, I can't thank you enough for joining us. So without further ado, I wanted to bring up, another part of our indie community. And this is my friend Trav. As I mentioned, our location independent or digital nomad community, tiny house living, is very, very challenged by stuff. So I was wondering what Trav would bring to this story sharing.
I was wondering myself up until maybe an hour and a half ago. And I think Bill hit it on the head. Like there's probably any item, especially if you are someone who tries to collect stuff that have stories or are useful, as Nora was talking about, you could pull off a shelf and tell a story about it, which is pretty neat. As I look around this room, But for me, the one that I'm going to talk about today, you know, like most people, I got married, and 2 months after that, we moved and lived in Japan for 2 years. All of you can relate to that, right? And we moved there, my wife and I, speaking no Japanese, knowing not a single other person who ever lived in Japan, and not even knowing what apartment we were going to end up in. It made it really challenging not to speak the language in Japan, but we persevered for 2 years. And over those 2 years, you know, I got to know some of the people who worked at the school that I worked at. I was a high school English teacher. And, you know, there's about 400 Japanese students. There's about 100 Japanese teachers. And there was one gaijin that was me, right? And I stuck out like a sore thumb. And there's probably about 3 people who spoke decent enough English to come in and chat with me day in and day out. One of those was not the guy who was about my age who worked in the office, but he was a super nice guy. We played soccer together and things like that. And about a year into my tenure there, he found out that I was going to a sumo match. You know, he'd come and ask me what I was doing on the weekend. He probably understood, you know, one word out of the 300 that I would say, just like that's how much I understood what he was saying. But when I said sumo, his eyes lit up and all. And I thought, okay, that's cool. Like, he understood that, right? I'm speaking a Japanese word, everyone. And, you know, and I went with a bunch of friends. It was amazing, really cool, traditional Japanese experience. One of the things that I loved about being in Japan was going to the sumo event, because I always loved sports. And so about 3 weeks later, he comes up to the English teacher, one of my coworkers, one of the 3 who spoke good enough English to really kind of be able to tell me something in depth. And she was like, hey, he really wants you to come down to the office. And, you know, as a kid, if you're in school and you're getting sent to the office, it's not a good thing. So I'm like, am I in trouble? Is this like, what's going on here? I was usually confused, but I was totally confused at this point. I walk down and he has something wrapped up for me, and he hands it to me. I was like, all right, this is like a random Tuesday. Why am I getting a gift? And the only thing that he said was like, sumo, like, you like sumo, right? And I was like, yeah, it's cool. And so I open it up and I'm there and it's this. And I was like, okay, you know, I was like, this is a really nice gesture, but what is it? You know, like, what does this mean? So it turns out, he gave me this. This is a handprint of a person named Hakuho, which is the Michael Jordan of sumo, the greatest sumo, that ever existed. And he was retiring that year. And so, I found out this a little bit later. I was touched by the gesture, but then I was, when the teacher came back to me and said, hey, Trav, like, do you understand what this is? I'm like, well, that was really nice. Like, I can't believe he gave this to me. She goes, yeah, imagine if there was a Japanese person who went to America, said they were going to a basketball game, and you went and found a way to get them a signed basketball by Michael Jordan. And I was like, yeah, that's pretty amazing. And so I still didn't get the full story of how he got it. One of his friends worked at a sumo stable. I don't know. He called in all these favors to get me this. And so, you know, from that moment on, I just thought, this is one of the nicest things that any human has ever done for me. Here's a guy who speaks probably 5 words in my language. I speak probably 15 in his language. We have these nonverbal relationship over 2 years that is nice, but hardly anything that's groundbreaking. And he thought enough of me and enough of me kind of having the courage to go to Japan to give me something like this. So, you know, I kept it for years. And one of the things that the second part of the story that's pretty awesome is that, you know, we moved around. Sorry, Marty, got one more. I'll be quick. We moved around a lot. We were travelers, you know, we didn't take much with us. And this just kind of kept finding itself in my life. Like, I'm like, I cannot get rid of this. It wasn't framed at that point. It was kind of rolled up. And I'm notoriously hard to get Christmas gifts for, because I just don't really want anything. And if I do want it, I just buy it for myself. And so my wife complains about that. And one time, you know, again, I would just say, you know, when we have a house and we're settled in, like, I want to be able to have this somewhere. And so one Christmas she came back, I don't even know how she dug through all our stuff, found this, got it framed with like professional museum level glass and gave it to me. And so every time I look at it, I think there are two amazing people in my life who gave this to me. And yeah, it just warms my heart.
Oh, wow. Oh, thank you, Trav. See,
yeah.
like Matt said, you know, even being location indie, even being minimalist, or we all can have those things that matter, and we hold on and move from place to place to place until we can put them on the walls, you know, or on the shelves or something. So thank you so much for sharing. I really appreciate it. And thank you for all you do to create the community that I'm now a proud member of too. So
thank you.
So I am going to, I know some people had to drop off, unfortunately, but I am going to bring Bill up on the stage because he is also has to leave soon. And I want to recognize again, my apologies for being not that great at managing time. But I did want to, before Bill leaves, offer him a chance to share his story. And I think it's perfect timing after yours, Trav. So with that, you can take it away, Bill.
Well, managing time is not the most important thing, Marty. You've done something beautiful here. So
thank you.
So I believe my mother might be still tuning in. So Mom, when I was in a junior in college, I went to study abroad, and I was in England, and I traveled to meet my friend Fred and my good friend Fred in Germany. And Mom, we hitchhiked a lot. And we went to East Germany, which at that point was still East Germany and was still behind the wall. And we got in, and then, you know, we spent some time there, and then we had to leave. And we had no idea where we wanted to go or what we wanted to do. We just had to get out of there. And so my friend, Fred, who spoke some German, I spoke not a word, made this sign that I keep, it says Ergenwo in a language I don't speak. And that means anywhere in German. And we held this sign up until someone picked us up and took us wherever they were going. I have no idea where it was. And I keep it because it reminds me of this time in my life where it really was the journey. The time, you know, it didn't matter when we got there. It didn't matter where we got. We just wanted to go and to travel. And that was, that feeling has been subsumed by having to pay insurance bills and, you know, mortgage and tuition and all the crap. And I feel like I'm just getting to a point in my life now that my kids are sort of out of the house where I can return to Ergenwo. I won't be hitchhiking though, Mom.
Oh my goodness. Oh, so I did see your mom on here. So and I'm like, that sounds like the name of another novel.
What, Things I Won't Tell My Mother?
Well, that, but the Ergenwo.
Oh, yes, that too.
Right? And I think, needless to say, with the location indie community, the digital nomad community, they'd all be about that. So I thank you very much. And I thank you so much for your time. And before you go, I just want to do, yes, I'm going to do a pitch. So whatever you do, do not buy the ebook. Of this.
Oh, terrible. It's terrible.
Don't do it. Don't do it. Buy the actual book. You will not. It is a beautiful, it won a photography, the best photo book, or what was it called, Bill? It won the best photography book of 2019 or something. One of the top 10.
It was a gift book thing. Not the best photo book.
But it's beautiful photography, and you need to have the actual physical book. It's in my little RV. It follows me everywhere. So thank you so much, Bill, for this
opportunity. Marty, thank you so much. And if anybody wants a Xerox copy of the Aragon Woe sign, just let me know. I'll send it to you.
I want one of those.
Thanks, right. Everybody. Thank you so much, Marty.
Thank you so much, Bill. I really appreciate it. We'll see you next time. Have a wonderful rest of your evening.
Bye, all.
All right. So next up, I am going to bring up on the stage, Caroline Gunter. So, and I'm going to take you off. Bye, Bill. Thank you. And Caroline is traveling. She is actually in New York City, where I was just last week, where several of the location indie people were last week after our camp. So she said, I have to bring either a photo or a piece of jewelry because I'm packing, because she's from the Chicagolands. So anyway, take it away, Caroline.
Thanks, Marty. I think this is also one of your really good segues. I think after Travis and Bill, I think it's the
Swedish organizer.
Yeah, I have a very similar story, so I hope it's not redundant to hear. But I was kind of struggling a little bit about what to pick for tonight, because I spend my time telling other people's stories. So I thought, you know what, I'm going to tell my story tonight in an unusual twist. For those of you who don't know me, I was born and raised in southern Sweden, and at the tender age of 18, after traveling throughout my teenage years also, I decided to emigrate to the United States, because why not? So before I show you my picture, let me just tell you a little bit about that. So I basically, I knew I had picked someplace cool when I chose Honolulu to go to. But when you think of Hawaii, you always picture this sort of, you know, paradise. And while it is, I had severe culture shock for a long period of time. I had, when I arrived, two bags. So again, at a very young age, I was faced with this whole idea of what do I bring? What matters to me? You know, it wasn't on this end of it. It was very early on, you know, what do I bring with me? What matters to me? So I remember bringing a photo of my family and a CD, basically, to listen to music and a change of clothing. And that was it. I had about $20 to my name, and landed in Hawaii, not knowing where I was going to stay, not knowing what I was going to do, or, you know, any of that. I really had nothing figured out. I was looking back. I don't know why they let me go. I was so green. As a young, you know, only child, you know, I have to give my parents props for letting me go. Long story short, you know, on the visa I was on, I was not allowed to have a bank account. I was not allowed to have a driver's license. Faced with very little money, no idea of how to find an apartment, not speaking English very well, a few words here and there. And the pidgin accent in Honolulu, if you've been there, is not the easiest thing to handle. So I would ask questions in kind of broken English, and they would talk back to me, and I would have no idea what they were saying. I had severe culture shock for 6 months or so. So what I brought was this picture of myself here, and this picture was taken, I don't know if you can see it, this was after I had figured out how to rent my first apartment. I'm just unpacking and putting up some basic furniture there. And you can see that it's the first time I'm actually smiling, because I knew at that point that everything was going to be okay, that I was going to figure this out. And I keep this on my wall because sometimes, I'm getting a little emotional, because sometimes, like, as an entrepreneur, you know, you think about yourself and you feel like, oh, I'm not far along in my business, or there's so much more I can do, or, you know, I should be here by now, right? But this kind of reminds me of how far I came in this past 20 years. So,
wow.
Yeah, I apologize for getting emotional, but it just, I clawed and scratched my way up, basically, to figure out, you know, who I am in this place, what I want to do. And yeah, just everything from figuring out how to drive to getting a bank account to all of these things that a lot of people take for granted. And keep in mind that this was in 1999, 2000. I didn't have a phone. I didn't know how to call home. I was on my own. I didn't have anybody to ask for help. So it is a very emotional thing for me to think back on. And I think it comes full circle for me because this is now like my life's work, right? This is what I do. I basically run three businesses. One is for photo organizing. As Kathy knows, I'm a photo manager, because without the photos, you know, what do we have? What stories do we keep? And I found that a lot of pictures that I have are just these small candid moments that if I don't actually tell the story, nobody would know. This looks like a regular picture that anybody would just throw away. But it's not necessarily about what it shows. It's more what it represents, right? Mm-hmm. So a lot of my photos are not events, because I'm the only one here, right? And now I have my husband, but he's from India. So, you know, he has the same type of story where we don't see our families all that much. And if I don't tell the stories of that, then, you know, who's going to know what this means? And then my second business is Scandinavian genealogy, focusing on immigrants, right? Immigrant stories. That's why I'm so passionate about telling those, because I relate to that. I know what that feels like when you don't know anybody and you don't know what to do. And so happy to see so many nomads here, because my third business is I'm a business coach for remote workers and digital nomads. That's how we live our life now. And we split our time, you know, between India and Sweden and the US and wherever we can go. So that's it.
Wow. Yeah. Wow. Thank you. I've known you for quite a while, I think. Like we met probably maybe a decade ago as part of the Association of Personal Historians, or APH.
Yeah.
That is no longer. But the association folded. There's plenty of people who are still doing the work. Yeah. But that's how we first met. And it's the first time I've heard a lot of your story. I mean, I remember you posting about getting your citizenship and having a flag. Yep. I remember that part. So I knew it was a process, but I didn't know.
That was 18 years of bureaucracy, right? And, you know, it's funny because a lot of people, you know, mistake me for American all the time. And I only think, kind of chuckle to myself. And I was like, you know, if you only knew how much work it was for me to get to that point. It's kind of funny to see.
Yeah. It's a lot of work. And you don't go through it, if you don't go through it yourself, or have a close family or friend who shares that journey with you, then you don't know what it's like. Yeah. So I hope that your daughter knows the story of that photo.
She does. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But thank you for bringing it all the way,
right?
Thank you for bringing it all the way from Chicago lands to New York City, so you could share with us this evening.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that was
thank you for this opportunity.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much. I think that is technically the end of what, at least according to my little notebook, because I think Leslie ended up having to leave. And Tilly, I know I saw the message from Tilly saying, and I think Reverend Yolanda ended up saying that and Judy did too. So is there anyone that's still on the call that was already in the lineup? If there is, let me know. Otherwise, I am going to just do two things and then I'm going to open it up for other sharing and connecting. So again, my apologies for not being so great at keeping track of time. This was wonderful having so many story sharers. I really, really appreciate it. I just wanted, one of the things I wanted to, a couple of questions I wanted to share with you, if I can figure out how to do it. Is, so as I've mentioned, I have, I'm a part of the Let's Reimagine community that is reimagining the end of life. But again, it's not like sad, there's not a sadness to it. It's just like, if we can pay attention and think about end of life matters, we can live more fully. And so one of the things is, as many of us have been talking about tonight, is, you know, that thing that you find is so important to you, the thing that you, or the things that you cherish. You know, we're just asking, what would it feel like to give it away? Or if it was lost, let's say, you know, just, you know, a lot of feelings get attached to these things, these objects. So no judgment, just a lot of feelings. So the other thing, as you heard several of our story sharers share, you know, have you thought about what you want to have happen to this thing when you die? Obviously, some people have been very clear. They've thought about it, and they know where it's going to go. So it's just one of the, and I find an important thing to think of. I haven't done all of this work either, just FYI. And lastly, if you were able to keep the story, would you be able to let go of the thing? So as Matt, who I don't think is still with us, he's on location filming, asks, you know, it is about the stories, not the stuff, right? So could you, if there's a way you could hold on to that story, would you be able to let go of the things in your life, or help your family members do that? Like we often end up, or we can be put in that position with a friend or a family member to help them with that process. So once again, a shout out to Kathy, who shared part of her 30th wedding anniversary with us this evening to share of the photo managers, and especially Kathy Stone and Faith Van Wart, who, and a few others. I think Gladys is here. I think Sharon might have been here too. A few others that joined our book club about what we keep. For inspiring this event, because realistically, if it weren't for all of that happening at the same time, I wouldn't have pulled this thing together. And so I just want to thank them. And lastly, I just want to say that I would love to stay in contact with all of you. If you came here through an email from me, then you're on my email list. If not, please follow me at Show and Tales. That's T-A-L-E-S. I'll put that in the chat in a minute. I'm on Instagram mostly. I do Facebook a little bit. Twitter, not really so much. But I would love to stay in contact with you and encourage you to look around your space and the space of your loved ones, and start asking people the stories of the things they keep. So I am going to open it up for the next chance to, oh, Chris, Corey, you're here, Chris. And so I just want you to, I mean, I want to open it up. We don't really have time for sharing stories so much, but I welcome you to go get off mute and say hello to one another. And I think we can, do I unmute everybody or can they unmute themselves? I'm gonna ask you all to unmute if you'd like to. You can unmute yourself and thank you so much, everybody. Thanks, Corey. I know you're in the middle of end of year, end of the month stuff. Thanks, Athena. I know you have to dash. A lot of people have to dash. I really, really am so grateful to all of you for staying around, sticking around with us, and sharing in. So, any last minute?
This was amazing. Thank you so much for putting this together. Thank you.
Aww.
This was a lot of fun, Marty. That's from from Canada that we're saying this was great.
Oh, thank you to my Canadians. And I know, Maria, you're there too. I don't know who else is there. Cameron is here from Ponga Pictures. Oh, yes. We have to, if you're looking for a really fabulous, fun, newish thing on the market, check out Ponga, ponga.com, I think. And it's a fun way. I think, Melissa, we've talked about it before. It's a fun way to add a voice note. You can actually add stuff to your photos. So it's really fun. I don't know a lot about it yet. I'm just learning, but it's a lot of fun.
Well, thank you very much, Marty, for that shout out. Appreciate that.
Yes.
A nice mention. And we would be happy to give anybody on the session a demo. We do things monthly. We have webinars monthly, but for this crowd, since you're all very focused around a specific opportunity, we'd be happy to schedule something very specific for you. So again, thanks, Marty, for the mention. And if you go to our website there, we do have a monthly Zoom-in session. We'd be happy to welcome any and all of you. And Kathy Stone is there typically and helps us conduct them. So she's very much a supporter and represents all of your issues and needs to us very, very dramatically. So
yeah,
thank you very much.
Yeah, that it would be great. So Cameron and we'll talk, Barbara and I and you will talk so that when I do a follow-up email, I can add that to my follow-up email.
Yep, terrific, Marty. Thanks so much. And apologize for no video. I've got a little bit of a laptop problem today, so.
It's not just me having problems. And thank you, Chris, for showing us you're at your office, but you're not in your seat anymore. Anyway. So thank you again. I really appreciate your time. It was such a fun event. I know Nancy ended up asking, yes, this is recorded. Yes. I'm not sure exactly how I'm going to share that yet. You know, I'm like learn as I go. But it will be, more than likely I'll put it up on my YouTube and then I'll share it out in one of the emails or I can send it directly to you. So.
This is great. This is wonderful.
I would like the link to it too. And also the chat, if you can do it.
Say what?
I was wondering if you could include the chat on that.
Oh, yes.
Is that something you can also, okay.
Yes.
There were a lot of good links in there.
Yes. I just saved that. I'll be getting that once we get off. It'll come into my Zoom and I'll send that to you. So hi, Teresa.
All right, thanks. Good night.
Good night.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you. We'll see you Sunday, Faith and Kathy.
And Lindy.
And who?
Lindy. Yes, Lindy, you'll come?
I'm hoping to, yes.
Awesome. Fantastic. Oh,
well, I hope to. We'll be traveling home from Iowa, so I'm not positive I'll be home in time, but I will try.
You do a lot of traveling, so that's a good thing.
Sometimes, right. Yes.
Wonderful.
Great
wonderful.
Session, Marty. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Enjoy your time in New York, Caroline. Thank you, everybody. Good night. Bye, everyone. Bye, Megan. Bye, Alex. Maria. Bye, Al. Bye, Faith.
Bye, Marty.
Bye. Hey. Bye, Megan. Okay. All right. Okay. Hello there. Who else is here? Okay.
Okay, Marty, I'm going to stop the recording right now.
Yes, that's great. Thank you.